Women. They weren't always featured in Olympic Games as they are today. Similar to the fight for women's suffrage, women had a fight for the right to compete. Alice Milliat, a French entrepreneur and women's rights activist, stood up against the unjust, discriminatory treatment women athletes received in the early 1900s. With the assistance of the Fédération Sportive Féminine Internationale, the Women's World Games, a strictly female Olympic facsimile, were fostered. Her efforts later contributed to cultural, social, and political changes, such as the inclusion of women into the Olympics. By taking a stand and fighting for women's rights, Alice Milliat drastically altered the lives of countless female athletes throughout the world, then and now.
Alice Josephine Marie Milliat, now known as Alice Milliat, was born in Nantes, France in 1884 to the petite bourgeoisie. Milliat's interest in sports grew once she started to spectate sporting events. Throughout her life, Paris, France was a sports hub of the world. It hosted many sporting events, including the Olympic Games in 1900 and 1924.
During these times, women were expected to stay home with their kids, as they were seen as unfit to participate in sporting events due to their fragile bodies. Women at most were included in 8 Olympic events. Not only were women supposedly not physically able to do the same activities as men, but they were also considered to be far less intelligent than those of the opposite gender. In 1914, World War I began. Men left their jobs and joined the army, and women filled their absent posts.
They became miners, woodworkers, and mechanics, and they excelled in those fields, proving that they could physically and intellectually compare to men, and that things that had been exclusive to men were now becoming available to able-bodied females. Women's clothing drastically changed from the garb of a housewife to the dress of a working woman, which greatly influenced the way they were perceived. At this time, they were beginning to earn some respect in the workplace, but they were still underestimated by the International Olympic Committee.
The International Olympic Committee, or IOC, opposed the idea of women in the Olympic Games. Although they could compete in sports like tennis, golf, archery, skating, and aquatics, women were not allowed to enter track and field events or any events that would be unappealing to a spectator. The founder and president of the IOC was Pierre de Coubertin. He strongly worked against the integration of women into the Olympic Games, and because of this, he became a rival of Alice Milliat. Coubertin believed that women had certain rights, but stated that women in the Olympics would be, quote, impractical, uninteresting, unaesthetic, and improper.
In 1915, 3 years after joining the Femina Sport Club, Milliat became president. In December of 1917, the Federation of French Female Sports Societies, or FSFSF, was founded with Milliat as treasurer. On April 28, 1918, the FSFSF held the first women's cross-country race in France, which set the stage for Milliat's later actions.
Over a year after the creation of the FSFSF, Milliat became president of the club, allowing her more freedom to stand up for their cause. In 1920 and 1921, Alice Milliat entered several pleas to IOC for women's involvement in Olympic events. However, these pleas were disregarded by Coubertin, who attempted to pass a motion to entirely exclude women from the Olympic Games shortly after. Although his attempt was unsuccessful, Coubertin remained staunch in his opposition to women's involvement.
Coubertin ended up gaining support from another man who opposed women in the Olympics as much as himself, Henri de Baylet-Latour. Baylet-Latour later succeeded Coubertin, and he tried to limit women to only 4 Olympic events. After her pleas were ignored, Milliat created the first international women's sports club in 1921 called the Fédération Sportive Féminine Internationale, or FSFI.
Women and the FSFI shared one common goal: to catalyze women's entrance into Olympic Games and allow their participation in more events. Remaining unheard still by the IOC, Milliat and her FSFI continued to stand up for the inclusion of women into Olympic Games by beginning to plan her own version of Olympics, which would occur 2 years after and before each Olympic Games. They set a date for the first women's Olympic Games, August 20, 1922. The first women's Olympic Games would be a one-day track meet, meant to be a female version of Olympic Games.
This announcement gave countries, like the United States, time to hold their own competitions, which were used to determine which women would compete in Paris. At this time, the FSFI contacted organizations all over the world, such as the National Education Association. The NEA believed that women should not partake in athletic events and tried to limit its female athletes' participation in track and field. The FSFI advised the NEA to work with them rather than oppose them. Although the NEA did not agree with the FSFI or the meet in Paris, they did not prohibit their athletes from going. The games were decided to be held at the Stade Pershing, located in Paris, France. The stadium had held many sporting events between England and France prior to 1922.
The Stade Pershing had all of the necessary equipment for the games and featured a track, throwing area, and jumping pit. On the day of the meet, about 20,000 spectators came to watch athletes from 7 countries participate in the first publicized female track and field meet. Women were able to compete in 11 different disciplines, in which they weren't able to in the Olympics, such as the 1,000-meter run and the high jump. This allowed women to break world records, though these records would not be recognized until later, and stand up to inequality.
Milliat became the first to stand up against the IOC in Olympic history and fight for gender equality, which laid the foundation for further advancements in women's sport. The 1922 Games forced society to realize that women are capable of anything men are, not only physically, but also mentally, as they had concocted a successful plan to reach their goals. Because of the success of the meet, another event was planned by Milliat for 1926 in Gothenburg. It gained more support from the crowds, and 8 countries participated in the second games compared to the 7 that competed in the first.
It was called the Second International Ladies' Games because the IOC did not allow the FSFI to continue using the word Olympic in their title as they did in 1922. In the 1928 Olympics, the International Association of Athletics Federations, or the IAAF, included 5 women to serve as an experiment. The longest race they were allowed to run was 800 meters. After women ran the 800 meter race, they collapsed due to tiredness, which motivated Bailette Latour to fight against women's Olympic track and field inclusion once again.
Despite the failure of the 800 meter race, women's participation in the 1928 Olympic Games did increase by 10% compared to the 1924 Games. Avery Brundage, another IOC president and successor to Latour, tried to continue the exclusion of women in middle distance races from that point on. The third and fourth Women's World Games followed Milliat's Gothenburg meet, occurring in 1930 in Prague and 1934 in London, both organized by Milliat's FSFI. The success of the Women's Games in 1930 and 1934 drew attention away from the Olympics, which angered the IOC. In 1935, in efforts to manipulate the IOC, Milliat asked for the exclusion of women from the Olympics. She claimed that it would allow women the freedom to coordinate their own games.
The IOC appointed the IAAF to handle this affair. The IAAF made a proposal. If the FSFI canceled the 5th Women's World Games and allowed it to be re-coordinated as a Women's European Track and Field Championship, the record set in the FSFI's previous games would be recognized. Women would also be allowed into the Olympic program in 9 new events. As this was the expected outcome, the FSFI accepted this proposal. Around this time, Milliat began speaking out about the importance of women's suffrage in regards to women's sport. Milliat claimed that earning the right to vote would allow them to, quote, make their needs publicly felt. She also believed that it would bring them greater acceptance and recognition to women's sport. By 1936, the IOC and IAAF realized the success and achievements of women and became eager to promote women's sport. Finally, in 1938, women were officially allowed to compete in Olympic Games as a direct result of Alice Milliat's first Women's Olympic Games, which is now referred to mainly as the Women's World Games.
Although the IOC did not allow the inclusion of women in the Olympics to promote equality, but to prevent Milliat from continuing to organize events that would draw attention away from the Olympics, women's integration into the Olympic Games did just that. It proved that women were equivalent to men and able to compete like them. Milliat became directly responsible for the development of female basketball, football, and many other athletics in France as her Women's World Games became an inspiration to women. In addition to this, Milliat's games also changed the way men and doctors thought about women. By the time women were allowed to enter the Olympic Games, people finally supported them and thought of them as more than mothers.
Women also began to show that they were mentally comparable to men, as a woman had devised something that forced men to change their rules. Alice Milliat temporarily disappeared from the sports world because she became ill around 1933 and could no longer coordinate meets for women. In 1945, women in France earned the right to vote, which allowed women the ability to voice their concerns about women's sport and gave them more power to access playing space and equipment, as Milliat had thought it would.
In 1957, Alice Milliat died, but her legacy of taking a stand against inequality lived on, as more women's events were being added to the Olympic program each year, such as hockey, judo, and wrestling. In 1981, Miss Pierre O'Hageman and Miss Flora Izova Fonseca became the first women to be admitted as IOC members, and in 1990, Ms. Fonseca became the first woman to be elected to the IOC Executive Board, both being unthought of prior to Milliat's crucial stand in history. A year later, the IOC imposed a new rule. Any new sport admitted into the Olympics must include women's events. In 1997, Miss Anita de France became the first woman elected as the IOC Vice President.
In 2005, a book was written about Milliat's conquests in the sports world. For the first time in 2012, every country competing in the Olympics sent women. Some even sent more women than men. Muslim women participated for the first time in Olympic history, much of this being a direct result of Milliat's pioneering role in women's sport. Alice Milliat, a women's rights activist, was the first to take a stand for women's sport against the IOC. After being dismissed by the International Olympic Committee and its president, Milliat took it upon herself to work for women's involvement in Olympic Games.
Milliat and the FSFI worked together to create the first women's Olympic Games, which set the substratum for further growth in women's sport and led to the ultimate incorporation of women into the Olympic Games. If not for Alice Milliat and her Women's World Games, female advancements in the sports world would have come much later. The female athletes of today are able to compete partly because of one woman's fight against inequality, that woman being Alice Milliat.